Howdy, y'all. I am so psyched you're here to listen to me preach about risk-based alerting, because it is definitely the coolest thing I have ever gotten to build as an engineer. So a little bit about me. That's Haylee Mills. I am a security strategist here at Splunk. And in a past life, I got to be the architect and content creator for a beautiful risk-based alerting system with some wonderful coworkers. And now I'm really grateful and excited to share the gospel, because I think once you see how powerful it can be, you'll be wanting to implement it as quickly as possible. So to go over the difference in what we're doing is we're moving from just alerting off of discrete data to connected behavior made out of that data. And this has us moving from these disconnected security events as alerts to contextualized security stories that are telling a story of behavior or observations and why that's interesting. And on top of all of that, we're getting more value out of our regular threat intelligence feeds, as well as building our own internal threat intelligence of interesting behaviors, whether that's interacting with IPs, hashes, or domains, or the command lines being run, so we could alert potentially off of both our objects as well as interesting or anomalous behaviors. So in my mind, I feel like this allows us to truly operationalize the wonderful MITRE ATT&CK framework, or use something like CIS-20, Killchain. We can even create our own framework depending on whatever interesting security metadata we want to apply to these individual data events. We can now track when those things are happening in unison. So this not only increases our security capability by being able to track interesting behavior in noisy places, but also our operational maturity and what we're able to respond to. And a lot of that is also due to the wonderful, vast reduction in alert volume with the increase in alert fidelity. And I know people might say, like, wait, if we're getting less alerts, aren't we technically seeing less? But ultimately, you're seeing so much more because you're embracing this noise, you are getting so many more observations, and then you're just alerting on it in a more intelligent manner. So I just want to go over, it's really just one more layer, one more step in between observation and alerting. And that's just applying those observations into the risk index. A way I like to see this is that basically for every user or system, we're just creating a bucket. Every interesting observation or useful thing we want to track, throw it in the bucket. And if we'd like, go ahead and throw some interesting security metadata right on top. And then we are only alerting when there's lots of interesting things in that little bucket. So we'll go over a bit of that in ES6.6 with a bit of a demo. So I'll hop over here to the incident review panel with our unfortunate amount of notables. I'm sure many of our analysts are familiar. And what's really the bummer is that this is good, juicy info, like system connections being discovered, processes being run from weird places, remote desktop protocol being used at all. Like, I want to know about this stuff. But a lot of times, if we're only making it informational or low urgency, it's never truly bubbling up into an alert. So with risk, that's going to make everything a lot easier. So 1566, oh, 33, that just feels so much better. I'm going to sort by our highest risk score here and notice B stole, very noisy user object. And we see they're firing both on the 24-hour risk score threshold as well as the number of attack tactics exceeded in 7 days. So what's cool about this is that we're not only able to catch these like small time frames, but also look for the type of low and slow or extended attacker behavior. So if we hop into this event, we'll see, oh my, looks like 9 tactics overall, as well as 16 techniques. We've got a bunch of individual risk rules and I mean, some of those alone look bad, but all of this together is looking real nasty. But before we dive into the risk event timeline for this risk object, I just want to point out real quickly the risk object category of technical and privileged. We've got a priority of critical, and then we see that this user is also on a watch list. So that will feed into the risk score, and I'll show you how a little bit later. So let's dive into the risk event timeline for BStole. And oh my, there is a stack of things going on, one after another right here. But looks like it's starting with Mishta running an HDA script out of the Microsoft Edge temp directory. And some data staging happening in that directory. Looks like we've got some PowerShell downloads going on here. And I mean, we see them move into the reconnaissance phase. And oh my, who am I being run by Notepad? That's not great. But you get the general idea of just having a lot of interesting behaviors. A lot of those we could not alert on directly. But now that we can use the risk model to frame them together and gather them together, now we can see it all here in the risk timeline. We could also go down here to the text-based, more detailed events, and we could see the details for just that event. We can also see the list of risk scores, the MITRE annotations, and the threat object. And in this one, looks like we've got a hash. Down here for the PowerShell one, we've got the command line for PowerShell running its badness. And going down further, looks like we got the recon commands. And then at the very end, where it looks like the attacker starts pivoting into the cloud the next day, we see the threat objects become the cloud users they are creating and adding privileges to. So again, we're tracking that behavior so we can look and see, has anyone else interacted with those as well? But I just wanted to show you that timeline view, but also, how does the magic happen? Well, if you're familiar with Splunk ES and correlation searches, there's really just a little extra going on here. So system network connections discovery, we're looking for net or netstat with these command lines. If you've been in an enterprise environment before, I could never alert on something like this. It happens so often, but it's still interesting. I do want to know that it happened. So the only thing different here is that we're adding a little security metadata with MITRE ATT&CK, and this is bringing additional enrichment from MITRE ATT&CK into the event. We could be using CIS-20, Killchain, and AST, or even making our own. And the rest of the correlation search is pretty similar to what we're used to. But at the end here, we have the risk analysis action rather than creating a notable. So we see the risk message giving us a little bit of information overall about what's happening from this event. And then we see a risk score of 10 being applied to the destination as the system and another 10 to the user. And lastly, we are tracking the command line so that we can be looking at this interesting library of behaviors as well and spot anomalies. Now, the way that this is alerting is really just another correlation search. So we've got the MITRE ATT&CK over 7 days search here, and we're looking into the risk data model, sorting it out by risk object, and then just looking for where the tactic count or source count, or excuse me, and source count is above the threshold, applying some additional severity there as well, which we could play with. And no need to add the annotations because that's for each individual risk event. We're looking over 7 days in this case, and then we're just popping out a notable. And that's what shows up in the incident review and shows up for your analyst with all the risk events and the timeline so they can start digging from there, but already being told the story. And if you were a very astute observer, you noticed the risk score in the search was 10, but they were showing up as 90. And that's happening because of the risk factor editor. So this first one we popped up on, source system category ICS. If the source category based off the identity and asset enrichment is ICS, we are multiplying that by a factor of 3. And Or we could do that with a MySQL database, bump it up by 1.5. The idea being that this is another way we can adjust risk score either up or down based on the attributes of that system or user. So in this case, we had the user as privileged. That's multiply by 2. We had the user priority critical, multiply by 2.25. And lastly, we had them as a watch list, bumping it up by another 2, making those risk events far riskier. So we could do that on a system as well and catch when a high value, high priority system is being fiddled with. It takes a lot less risk to make it pop off. And we could multiply it, we could do addition or subtraction. But either way, the cool thing about this is that you get so many knobs and levers to turn with like your risk bonsai. It feels like you're cultivating an ecology more than just, you know, creating alerts and popping more alerts out the other end. You're like playing with what happens on the other end. So that's as much as I am able to show in the demo. Thank you so much for following along. Do reach out to your Splunk rep to get you started on the RBA journey. It takes a few steps and reorganizing how you do things, but the value is so worth it. And I'm sure you'll find all sorts of cool things you could do with it. So thanks for joining and happy hunting.